Good evening. Welcome to the February meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council. Before we begin, would you all please rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Can we have the roll call, please?
Chairman Garvin.
Here.
Councilor Grennan.
Here.
Councilor Caitlin Jordan. Councilor Penelope Jordan.
Here.
Councilor Lennon.
Here.
Councilor Ray.
Here.
And Councilor Sullivan.
Here.
We'll begin with town council reports and correspondence. Does anybody have anything that they want to report at this time? Councilor Grennan?
Yeah, thank you. So I want to just report that the next meeting of the ordinance committee is tomorrow morning, February the 16th from 8 to 9:30. That'll be in the lower level conference room here at town council. And as well, the Ordinance Committee on February 28th, that is a Tuesday, will be attending a special events conference put on by the Maine Municipal Association. And it is entitled Lifting the Haze, Marijuana and Legal Considerations. So that will begin our journey on the conversation about the new marijuana legalization law and how it potentially affects Cape Elizabeth.
Thank you very much, Patty. Any questions for Patty? Go ahead, Penny.
Yes, I just wanted to let people know that the next meeting of the Comprehensive Planning Committee is going to be March 8th, and it's here at the Town Hall at 7 o'clock in the William H. Jordan Conference Room. And we want to engage the community and citizens as much as possible during the comprehensive planning process. We had a great turnout at the last meeting, and what we're focusing on at this point in time is seeking, putting out RFP for consultants to help us engage the citizens of Cape Elizabeth in this process. So stay tuned for more, and please call, ask questions, send emails about what's happening with that.
Thanks, Penny. Any questions for Penny? Other reports? Mm-hmm. Councilor Sullivan?
I'm serving this year as the town's finance chairman, and I met on the 25th of January with the school board's finance chair, Joe Morrissey, as well as our business manager, Catherine Messmer, to review the process this year, which will be the same as last year, and the upcoming dates. So we're all set on that. The town council will begin its own review of municipal accounts on March 21st. That's a Tuesday. You've got your dashboard before you. Wait a minute. Yeah. I'm on the wrong thing. This is regular reports and
that's
not
fine. Go ahead.
Financial.
Pardon? Go ahead.
Sorry about that. I had this out of order. Well, anyway, okay. Dashboard, you can see where we are as of January 31st. Things are looking quite good. We have a couple variances on the general report that I'd like to mention. There was quite a nice increase in excise taxes, are up 62%, so I guess a lot of our residents are buying cars this year. And the boating excise tax is down 881%, which I thought was a timing issue, but I did ask our town manager, so I'll ask him to speak to that.
Sure, sure. Ultimately, the pleasure crafts will come online once ice comes out. Rough way to put it, the majority of our boat registrations happen after the first of the year, so we should be seeing those revenues come online as the days warm up.
The weather gets
hopefully.
Nice.
Yep.
Thank you. And also, I just thought it would be nice to point out that our revenues for our fitness center are up 69%, and that's particularly gratifying for those of us that were on the council a few years ago when we were having revenue problems, and we did make the decision to go ahead and invest in new equipment for the fitness center, which is next to the pool here. So it's nice to see such a strong indication that people are using the fitness center. So I just wanted to mention that. Anyway, with the dashboard, I have a couple other reports, but with the dashboard, I did want to mention, as I reviewed this with Matt Sturgis before we put it together and with Catherine, the overlay is pretty healthy.
Yes.
Right now, and so I'd like to ask the town manager to just review that with us. That's not on here per se, but...
No, it isn't, but...
But if you could just tell us about that.
Sure, sure. The overlay is ultimately the difference between... there's three different components that make up the overlay, and it's the difference between what the net amount to be raised for taxes, meaning that you're going to raise X amount of dollars, which will make us completely whole to the penny, and then by rounding a little bit, so you go up, instead of having a tax rate of, say, 1753, we go to 1754. It ends up giving you a little bit of a gap by that one, by using an even number versus an odd number. You can go up to 5% greater than the amount to be raised by law. We generally are a couple percentage points above that. So so you have the net to be raised, which is greater than, or ultimately when you set the tax rate, the amount that is raised is a little bit greater than the net to be raised. So the difference between that and the other is part of the overlay. Then there are two other components in the overlay, one of which is reimbursement that we receive from the state for our homestead exemption. Mm-hmm. So ultimately, the town participates in half of that. This year, the exemption is $15,000. So the town funds $7,500 of that exemption, and then the state has to provide us the other half of what that exemption amount is. And that's roughly about $250,000 in revenue this year. And then we also receive an additional revenue from the state, which is business equipment tax exemption reimbursement. So what that is related to is there's business equipment in the town of Cape Elizabeth that is taxed or it's assessed, but it's exempt from taxation by law. The legislature and the governor has decided that certain qualifying equipment is exempt from tax, but by declaring that exempt, they have to reimburse the town for half of the revenue that we would have received otherwise. And so that's roughly about $12,000 that the town receives. So you've got the difference between what the net to be raised in and is and the amount that we actually raise, the homestead exemption reimbursement, and the business equipment tax exemption reimbursement. And all of that in the current year resulted in about $370,000 difference in an overlay.
To the positive.
To the positive. Mm-hmm. So at the end of the year, after everything is reconciled, say we have abatements that take place throughout the year, that's really the biggest draw that may come from the overlay. That revenue that's left is a designated surplus, if you will. So it's kind of like, you know, money that we received, but we haven't a home for spending it. So that goes into, in a sense, our savings account. You know, there's a leap of faith that the state's going to cut those checks, for one. So that's why we don't count on it until the check clears, much as we do in our own home accounting. But ultimately, those are the difference. By the end of this year, we're looking at a very healthy overlay net result. When the books are finally closed, we're probably looking at roughly about $350,000. That'll go into the unassigned balance at the end of the year. So that's kind of your overlay 101 there. But but we should be seeing that go forward, and then the town will be able to use that in following years. But on the current year, it's not a revenue or an expense that we employ. It's a function of mathematics at the end of the commitment process of taxation.
Thank you, Matt.
Thanks, Jessica.
Thank you. Did anyone have any questions on the dashboard that you've got? And this is on the packet online in color, so it's kind of, I think the color helps you go through the columns. So anyway, if I may, Jamie,
please.
I just had a couple other things to mention. Matt and I were at the Metro Coalition of Governments, and they are working on gathering data for benchmarking so that we'll be able to see how Cape Elizabeth lines up with other communities in Greater Portland with our revenues and our expenses. We did have at that last meeting, which was yesterday actually, an outstanding report from the Falmouth police chief about what Falmouth is doing to combat the opioid crisis. So more of that will be coming forward for the community as a whole, I think, through the Metro Coalition. It was very sobering. And I just wanted to mention that I think we have a really terrific report online from our tree warden, Mike Duddy. I don't know if anyone has seen it, but he's the town's tree warden, and he's written an article about the winter moths. And I, for one, had so many moths on my storm door in December, I couldn't even see out the door. I'm already losing trees. So especially for people at home, if you haven't had the chance, go on the town website, please, and take a look at that and read it. Because what we're going to be doing is getting these flies that kill the moths. And people are, the tendency, and he discusses this very nicely in the article, but the tendency would be for you to use pesticides to kill moths. Don't do it. He's urging people not to do that because you'll end up killing the flies that are going to be very instrumental in getting rid of these moths, but it's going to take about 10 years. It's a very interesting article, and I just think we're very fortunate to have a tree warden of Mike's stature, and then this is a really interesting article, so I hope everybody gets to read it. That's it.
Thank you. Any questions for Jessica? Any other reports or correspondence for anybody? I have a few things. First, I want to welcome Matt to his first meeting as town manager. We're excited to have you here and looking forward to great many years ahead. I want to thank Deborah for serving as interim manager while we were in between. So thank you very much for stepping up and doing the extra work. It was much appreciated. Tonight's meeting was rescheduled from Monday. We obviously had a massive snowstorm. I'm sure you'll probably touch on it in your report, Matt, but I want to thank the Public Works Department, Public Safety Departments, the Facilities Departments for a tremendous amount of work to turn around the town and have it be safe and, safe for everybody to travel about and get the kids back to school on Tuesday. I know that some of our neighboring communities were a little lagging behind, so we'll puff out our chest a little bit about that. And lastly, it's at the end of the agenda, but we do have a workshop immediately following this meeting, just so everybody's aware about that. So with that being said, is there anybody from the public that's here that would like to speak to something that's not on the agenda? No? Seeing none, we'll move on to your monthly manager's report, Matt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yep.
First of all, I'd say I'm honored to be here. This is great. Really was looking forward to Monday night, and I had to subside my enthusiasm to tonight. So I'll try to be brief. To begin with, I'd like to take the opportunity to thank Bob Malley and the Public Works Department and its on-call plow operators for their efforts in battling 5 weather events in the last 8 days. If you think about that, there's some serious sleep deprivation going on with our Public Works guys, and they are powering through. Their stamina, determination, and amazing results are simply above reproach. They're out there again this evening, or they should be later on this evening, with what we anticipate should hopefully be the last event for a while, and we hope that they can keep up the great work. We'll say, as a person who drives through multiple towns to get here, the results are extraordinary. The road conditions here are great. I'm really proud of the work they've done. I've kept in great contact with Bob throughout both of all of these events to see where we were at, and the guys have really responded well. I'm proud of that. I've had a busy first 2 weeks in my position as town manager. I've met with all department heads to individually discuss their plans, their current challenges, and the status of their departments, and these meetings have been educational. I attended a GPCOG regional forum with Councilor Sullivan in South Portland at their city hall, and this forum focused on identifying regional issues that are challenging our surrounding cities and towns. Some of the issues identified are stable tax rates, aging in place successfully, and other issues, many of which we're all discussing. It was great to find the commonality. I also attended the Metro Regional Coalition meeting yesterday with Councilor Sullivan. The primary focus of the meeting was an informational presentation by Lieutenant John Kilbright of the Falmouth Police Department. He updated the group on the origins, current impacts of, and current approaches to battling the opioid epidemic. The impact locally on many of the surrounding communities is shocking. After returning from the meeting, I spoke with Chief Gleason and inquired of the impact here in Cape Elizabeth. The chief told me that Narcan was used twice in Cape Elizabeth over the past year, which is much less than the surrounding communities. However, there are other impacts that we may feel, an increase in crime or other impacts that may flow from this epidemic. There will be a strong attempt at a regional response to this issue, so we'll keep you updated as those efforts flow forward. I have an upcoming meeting on Friday morning with the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust to discuss our common motivations. I'll also be meeting with the town engineer, public works director, and planner to review upcoming municipal projects. Speaking of projects, the Recycling Center pre-bid meeting received a high level of interest, with 13 different organizations expressing preliminary interest in the project. So that should maintain, hopefully, strong competition. The bid opening for the project is March 9th at 2 p.m., and the anticipated groundbreaking is April 10th. Finally, I received a financial benchmarking data request from Jim Gailey, as Councilor Sullivan has mentioned. He's the county assistant county manager, and I'll be responding with our Cape Elizabeth data. And this is related to valuation, expenses, revenues, and other financial elements of our operations here. Once the data is complete, I'll be receiving a copy of the completed study, and I'll be sharing it with council to see how we measure up to our peer communities. And that's all I have for manager's report, Mr. Chairman.
Great, thanks. Any questions for Matt? Seeing none. Next item is the review of draft minutes from our regular January 9th meeting and our special meeting on January 18th. Looking for a motion to approve the minutes.
So moved.
Patty, is there a second?
Second.
Penny, any discussion? All those in favor? Great. Item number 472017, our draft 2017 goals. I'll introduce this. So we've spent a couple of different workshop meetings assembling our goals for the year. They're included in the packet that was posted online tonight. The work represents, I think, a very good collaborative effort from all of the councilors, and I thank you all for your input and patience during the process. I know it was a little bit different than maybe we've done in the past, but I think where we got to was very productive, and I'm personally very pleased with the outcome. So with that being said, I'll look for a motion to approve the draft 2017 goals.
I recommend that we accept the draft of the 2017 goals as presented.
Thank you. Is there a second? Patty, any discussion?
I'd like to say something.
Go ahead.
I have to say that having gone through goal setting with the previous town council, and which we turned out a pretty good product, I really think what we produced here is a very enduring framework that can serve councils for many years, because we can then change the content of the opportunities, but the framework, I think, will last a long time. So, Jake, I think you did an awesome job, so thank you.
Appreciate that. Penny?
I guess I will echo Penny's comments. I just want to quickly say that I do like the new format with the five goals. I feel like they're memorable and repeatable, which is important. And I feel like with doing that, it is the first time that I feel that we're aligning ourselves as a council with these goals and giving us kind of a shared vision to move forward. So thank you for your work, and as well, Penny, for your input. Appreciate it, and all of our input.
Thank you very much. Any other discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor? Great, thank you very much. Next item, number 48-2017, accessory structures recommendation from the planning board. You wanna go ahead and introduce this, rather?
Sure, I sure will. So what we're looking for this evening is for council to refer this to recommendation from the planning board to the ordinance committee for review. And you might remember a few months ago that the council approved technical amendments to the code of ordinance, but referred to the planning board the use of accessory structures for seasonal farm workers. And this came out of this feeling or the desire to do this came out of a letter that came from Jay Cox, who is the owner of Old Farms Christmas Tree Place. The planning board has finished their review, and they brought it before us. You've seen that. And at this point, we want to send it along to ordinance committee. So with that, I will move to refer the planning board recommendation to the ordinance committee for review.
Thank you. Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Penny, discussion? Jessica?
Yes. I was curious as to, well, I guess I would request clarification of why we're going to send it back to ordinance after all, given that the planning board is recommending we not change anything. So my question is, why do we need to send it back to ordinance and at all? Are we creating unnecessary work?
Patty, do you
want to comment on that? We actually have it on our agenda for tomorrow morning with council's blessing and approval to pass it along. I expect that it'll be a very swift review and will be handed right back to council for approval at the March March meeting. But a good question.
Sarah?
Can I ask a planning board member a question?
Oh, please, yeah. Sorry.
Did you guys address the central issue of why this got sent to you?
Yes,
so
we did.
So Jay Cox came to your meeting and explained what he...
Yes, we reviewed the email came to us in October, and we had three workshop meetings and a full planning board meeting. And we came to the conclusion that all of the activities and uses that he was worried about not being allowed were in fact allowed under the ordinance.
And did the member of the Cape Farm Alliance who you referenced that you heard from, did that person, do you think, represented most of the Farm Alliance and they felt comfortable with it?
I believe so.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
So, Jessica, on your concern, in previous discussions around this, my understanding was that simply as a matter of keeping with, for lack of a better word, protocol of, you know, having things go for even with the minimal amount of changes, that it still is keeping with our process to go back to the ordinance committee. As Patty indicated, it would seem quite likely that nothing would come out of that other than moving it back onto the council. But I have no objection to that as a matter of process, in spite of the fact that it's slightly less efficient than it would otherwise be. But I'm open to others' opinion on that as well. The motion on the floor is to refer it to the ordinance committee. That's what we're discussing. Are there other comments, Jessica?
Yes, if I could ask, if I could ask another question.
Sure.
I didn't know if he was gonna make any presentation about the planning board's work on this, anything else?
Nope, Patty said it all.
Okay. Did you receive the information regarding the, this is, I'm reading from a memorandum, the innovation type activities that people from the Cape Farm Alliance anticipate? Did you receive all that you were comfortable with?
Yes. So in the memo, we listed a few ordinance sections which would support everything that we saw. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, to date, no permits have been denied for anything that we know of. So I think we're set.
Thank you.
Other comments, questions? Seeing none, all those in favor of referring the planning board recommendation onto the ordinance committee? Opposed? Great. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for being here. Appreciate it. Next item up is number 49-2017, shooting range ordinance referral. I'll again turn it over to Councillor Grennan to introduce this.
Yeah. Jimmy, I suspect we might have some public comment.
Yep.
Do you want to first just open it up short?
Yeah, briefly just summarize what it is we're talking
Absolutely.
About here.
I just want to make sure we didn't miss that.
Yep.
Regarding item number 49, we will be asking Council to refer the shooting range ordinance to the ordinance committee for review. And the reason that we are doing this is, you remember the shooting range committee originally wrote and drafted the ordinance, they expressed the thought that at some time in the future, we might want to take the opportunity to kind of do a look back once the ordinance was up and running and working, and to look at that more from a tweaking purpose with a technical review versus a complete changing of the ordinance. And that would be more of a procedural review to see, you know, and talk to Chief Williams and talk to Ben McDougall and see how it is going as far as the enforcement piece with it. Again, we would expect no major changes at all, and it's just looking for referrals so we can kind of look at that, and from a practicality process enforcement view, see if there's anything that we need to just tweak a little bit so that there is clarity going forward, and it's a cleanly written ordinance that works for all those parties involved. So with that, I will make a motion to refer the shooting range ordinance to the ordinance committee for review and technical revisions.
Is there a second?
Second.
Sarah? Is there anybody from the public that wishes to speak on this item?
Hello, good evening. My name is Mark Mayhome from the Spurwink Rod and Gun Club. President Walter and myself went through the ordinance word by word, and we suggested a few what we considered technical revisions to it that would be a little bit more clarifying, in hopes that when we're no longer on the front table of the club and the council is no longer here and all the faces have changed in the neighborhood, that it would be a very clean document that in the future would be very easy to read, very easy to interpret, and those are why we put the revisions in that we put in, so that there would be any ambiguity that would be in there would be gone. So I hope you have a chance to take a look at those.
Thanks. Anybody else from the public that wanted to speak about that? No? Questions or comments?
I have a quick question. Did you submit that to Maureen?
Yes.
O'Meara. Okay, great. Thank you.
Sarah?
I might be behind the eight ball here, but I have a couple questions. First of all, my memory is that we, in the ordinance committee, was the one that we pulled out to send back because we're no longer having a committee composed of citizens. Is that correct? It's going to be the committee to approve the license every year is us. Am I correct in that? Or are we still drafting? What? Or is that just a proposal that we're considering?
So, would you like me to answer?
Go ahead.
Based on the, we did put it out for the appointments process, and nobody stepped forward. So we, by default, the council is now the shooting range committee. This is one of the things we'll be looking at, figuring out these components as we move forward. So that's a really good question, and I think we'll just be tackling that as well.
Yes, wait, I have a question.
Okay.
So when do you guys have to apply for this year's, what's it, permit license? Do you have to do a yearly thing where you get a permit?
That was part of the, that's part of what was a little ambiguous. We weren't sure if we had to reapply each year or if it was just an inspection that was done, like in some of the other surrounding towns.
So right now you're okay and open?
Correct.
You're not like waiting on us to, because all of this is so much in flux. So everything's okay for right now and there's time to craft this?
Correct.
Collaboratively. Okay. That's what I was wondering.
Good.
Any other questions or comments?
Thank you.
Thank you. Seeing none, all those in favor of moving the ordinance referral, shooting range ordinance referral, onto the ordinance committee? Seeing no opposition, that passes unanimously. Thank you. Do we need to actually table that?
I don't think you actually need to just take no action.
Okay.
Yeah.
So item number 50-2017, Tower Overlay District request for rezoning. It's 19 Wells Road. Matt, do you want to briefly update us on that?
Sure. To quote an overused phrase recently, due to weather conditions on Monday, the applicant for this request had travel issues that wouldn't allow them to make it here this evening. So they requested to be carried over to the March meeting. Since it was a referral to the planning board, I gave them the option. They wanted to have the council take action to refer it, and they felt that it would be best if they had the opportunity to tee it up properly and introduce this concept, and they asked to come in March. So okay. I don't think the council needs to take any action if we want to just carry it over to the next month, because it's not a table. I don't think you have to table it at this point.
Okay. Everybody good with that? Great. Moving on. Item number 51-2017, Fort Williams Park Group use request for 2017. We have four different requests presented by the Fort Williams Park Committee, recommended by them for approval here. The Cape Little League, high school commencement exercises, Family Fun Day, Making Strides, Breast Cancer Awareness Walk. All things that have been past uses and I think are just before us to approve again for this year. So is there a motion to approve these recommended uses for Fort Williams Park? Sarah, is there a second?
Oh. Are you? So moved.
There you go. Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Patty? Any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor? Great. Item number 52-2017, the presentment of the Alternative Energy Committee's report. Patty, I'll turn it to you to kick this off, and then I know we've got a couple of people from the committee here that will take us through a little bit of a presentation.
We do. Thank you so much. Yeah. So it is with great pleasure that I introduce the Alternative Energy Committee's work this evening. As you all know, earlier tonight, we as a council unanimously approved our 2017 goals. And in these goals, the council states a desire for Cape Elizabeth to be a sustainable community, specifically a community that implements policies and projects to improve the social, economic, and environmental well-being of the community. The Alternative Energy Committee report before you recommends two separate solar projects for Cape Elizabeth. It is the committee's hope that the council will consider adopting and implementing these recommendations to move our community forward, thereby taking us one step closer to achieving our written and shared sustainability goals. It was less than a year ago that the committee was given a charge. They were asked to explore opportunities to provide alternative energy to municipal and school buildings as well as town vehicles. The ultimate outcomes and recommendations in the report are well researched, based on facts, and what the committee, made up of five community members, all experts in their own right in the solar energy field, determined to be the most viable renewable energy projects for Cape Elizabeth. So before we hear a brief presentation of the Alternative Energy Committee's report, I'd like to take a moment to publicly thank the committee and our town staff liaison for lending their time, talent, and expertise to deliver a report with a clear mission. A mission with a goal of inspiring the council and the community to pursue sustainable energy projects. That is, projects that engage in low risk, high reward outcomes, that capture long-lasting benefits from energy efficiency, as well as renewable energy technology, all while proposing to significantly reduce our energy costs and carbon footprint here in Cape Elizabeth. So without further ado, I'd like to publicly acknowledge and thank the 2016 Alternative Energy Committee. Unfortunately, because of the weather on Monday, a few of the members could not be here this evening as we changed the meeting. I'd like to now, are the remaining members in the council? I was going to have you stand, but I don't think we need to at this point. This is our Alternative Energy Committee. And we have before us James Massey, Loren Schmidt, Richard Smith, Julia Bassett-Schwerin, Wes Stone, and our staff liaison, Greg Marles, Director of Facilities and Transportation in Cape Elizabeth. So thank you. We really appreciate your service to Cape Elizabeth. If you could join me to say thank you. So before we move forward with the council's comments and questions and a vote to acknowledge the report, I cleared with you, Jamie, that we were going to have a brief presentation. And Julia Schwerin is at the podium. So Julia.
Hi. Thank you very much for allowing us to speak tonight. We really appreciate it. So our committee was founded as a response from the town council to our citizens. And as Patty mentioned, we were all from different backgrounds and came together to execute our mission statement, which is to facilitate the delivery of the best available decision-making information, to empower you, the town council, and to inspire the community to engage in low-risk and high-reward projects that capture the immediate and long-lasting benefits of energy efficiency and renewable energy technology by significantly reducing our energy costs as well as our carbon emissions. And as part of our plan that we executed, we had a lot of different activities. One of those was to go out to local towns and to look at the towns around us to see what they were doing, doing well and sometimes not so well, to get ideas. So there are some of the ideas that we had from our neighbors. And then as a second part of our job, we looked at all the major types of renewable energies, and we actually looked at some not so major types of emerging technologies that we could possibly propose to the town. And then another activity that we engaged in was to study the town's energy usage patterns and existing systems so that we could make a really good match between the technologies and our unique town's usage. We found that the town already had two arrays of solar thermal for hot water that were installed and are working very well, and you can find them on top of our schools on the campus. So we decided to propose solar energy as our main recommendation, and we did it because we felt that it was the best match to the town, and also it's the case that homes and businesses in our town already are using solar photovoltaic and sometimes solar thermal in their own energy usage patterns, and it's really a growing activity in our town. This chart shows a typical probably summer day of solar gain from both solar photovoltaic and solar thermal technology, where the peak sun is during the middle of the day, and the blue is typical home's energy demand. So a lot of times homes need to store energy either using batteries or using net metering, which is a way of using the grid as a big battery. But we did not factor that into our recommendations because the main user of energy in our town is the schools, and the schools are mainly using that energy during the daytime hours. So we were able to avoid any of the complexities of net metering in our recommendation. Another thing to note that I think is significant is that most people are able to leverage investment tax credits to reduce the costs of their solar investments. As a municipality, we don't pay taxes, so we can't take advantage of any tax credits. And there's no current state incentives for solar energy in Maine. However, there are a number of very well-established investors who are willing to set up what's called a power purchase agreement with businesses, homes, and municipalities, whereby they use the tax credits and give a guaranteed electricity rate for a period of time. So they're able to guarantee that our electricity rate will stay the same, usually for the first 7 years. That could be continued into the future, but there's also a very attractive buyout option in the contracts that allow the entity who is the host of the technology to buy it out at a very attractive rate. We also wanted to make sure, and as part of our charge, to use low-risk recommendations. So we wanted to emphasize that there's already a really established track record for solar in the state, many businesses locally to install it and maintain it, many of which we interviewed for our study. So we were confident that the technology was established and low risk. So we recommended two projects. We'll go into these in greater detail in the workshop. The projects that we recommended uses the best numbers that were available at the time that we created them. And we are confident that they have really good economics for saving energy costs for the town. We chose a somewhat modest solar thermal project for the Richardson Pool that has an 11-year payback for the energy-intensive heating of pool water using a solar thermal system, coupled with a small solar photovoltaic system for operating the pumps. This system is highlighted in blue as project number one. And this project, we believe, can be designed by the facilities department itself and paid for out of the town budget due to its low cost and attractive payback characteristics. So we recommend an RFP be created for this project in the near term. And the second project we recommend is also in blue, and that's a large-scale solar array to be located on town land, also called a greenfield, And we recommend creating an RFP for an engineering and design service that can work with the facilities department due to the greater complexity and permitting required to roll out that system. And this will cost between $30,000 and $50,000. I want to stress that these two projects are going to save significant expenditures on fuel and electricity with a short payback and low risk that allows many years of virtually free energy. And although these are very conservative payback periods that we have put in our report, the actual life expectancy of these systems could be quite longer. So we've formed a great team, and we'd like to also ask that we are able to convert from being an ad hoc committee to being a standing committee and to shepherd these recommendations through the process, and also to do something that we also really believe in, which is to involve the schools and townspeople in education on the implementation of these projects. So we look forward to providing more detail in the workshops and answering all your questions, and thank you for the opportunity to serve on this committee.
Thank you very much. I echo Patty's thanks, and I'm sure I speak for the entire council in thanking you all for the tremendous work that you've done. The commitment of your time and talent to this initiative has been greatly appreciated, so thank you very much for that. Very much looking forward to having a more in-depth discussion at our workshop on the 28th is when we're meeting for that. So this has been a great introductory sort of summary, but really looking forward to digging in on it a lot further and discussing later on some of the recommendations that you've made. So thank you all very much again. And with that, go ahead and make a motion. Yeah.
Great. I'd like to make a motion to acknowledge receipt of the report from the 2016 Alternative Energy Committee with referral to a workshop on February 28th, 2017.
Thank you. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Penny? Any discussion? Jessica?
Yes. In advance of that workshop, there were several tables that were in. I got a paper copy in advance, and the print is so small that I can't really analyze them effectively. And so before the workshop, if it's page 28 and page 29, and also pages 28 through 33, if there's any way you could get those into, I think it's 11 by 15 or whatever.
11 by 17, yeah.
11 by 17,
sure.
In paper, so that
right.
We can go through them.
Absolutely. Deb, you and I can coordinate on that and figure that out. Super. Thank you.
Any other comments or discussion? Jessica?
Yep. I didn't see, as I was going through this, any reference to the really substantial 2008 Alternative Energy Committee report that the Town Council did. I believe you were on that committee, Sarah. And so I don't know if you reviewed that. And I was wondering what comparisons you would have made or maybe
sure.
Haven't made, or it was a pretty big report, so I was just looking for what's different between 2008.
They did. That was definitely the starting point, a jumping off place, and they spent a lot of time looking at what was done, what was accepted, and why it was not moved along, and maybe somebody else wants to speak from the committee. But I think that they looked at the energy consumption, and we really just moved ourselves quickly from that to today and went from that. But there was time spent.
Good. I didn't see anything in writing about
it. No, good question.
So if there's any way that, because that was a 100-plus page report, really substantial. And I know you were on that committee, Sarah. So if there's any way that you can document what you compared and what you took from that, I think that would be a critical piece, because there was a great deal of work done on that, and it would be so fascinating to see how that was in 2008 and why, where we are now, 8 years
sure.
later.
James Massey, perhaps you
sure. I think there were major changes.
Jim, can you come to the podium, please?
I'm just speaking without a mic. There were major changes in both systems and costs over this period of time. Feasibility has become a reality. I think, at this time, and even more so in another year. So I think this is the major difference. Some of the suggestions that were made on the earlier one were considered, but not given credence because of their adaptability to our town at this time. I think we mentioned that in the beginning of the report.
Well, there was an energy analysis, but it wasn't. It didn't refer to this
specific referral.
So I was a little confused on
Fine.
What you were actually referring to. So, you know, if you have a chance to do something, that I think that'd be really valuable because I don't know. If you,
yeah,
the you may not at this point. I just
yeah. The committee
curious.
At this point no longer yeah. exists. Mm-hmm. So to meet and do and degree is it we did expire. Certainly we can put that
okay.
to Greg Marles and have a conversation at workshop. And I think we can probably
I'll look into it myself as well.
Okay.
For sure. Yeah.
yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Great.
I think
Sarah?
That's a great idea, Jessica. I don't think it has to be a lengthy. Written, but
yeah,
just a quick touch note, because as I read this, I did read it with an eye, because I was the council liaison on that one, and it was really interesting to me to see what, like we spent a lot of time talking about geothermal, and you guys said geothermal is a great thing to look at maybe in the future with new building, but it doesn't make sense now. You did, in other words, you gave nods to what the other report had said, and also we talked a lot about natural gas, and you guys basically said, solar's leapt ahead of that now. So just some connections or some transitions, I think, are really helpful. Like, in my mind, they were there a little bit, but I had the same curiosity that you had, just so it seems like a consistency of that we've been doing this as a town for a decade.
Well, it's a similar concept of, you know, we review a comp plan every year. We had a huge 100-plus page energy report in 2008. It'd be very nice to have written documentation of, okay, well, that this was the cost of electricity at that point in time. Here it is here. These were the costs of panels. Here they are today. You know, just something. Some continuity of.
Even if we talk about the workshop,
yeah.
I do think that would be helpful.
Yeah.
I think that
All right. We'll produce something.
Yeah,
I think.
We can even just discuss it.
What struck me, and I think is just an interesting editorial aside, is that there are many things, as you just alluded to, that we look at year over year or 5 or 10 year period over 10, you know, different things that not a lot changes. You know, people's attitudes may change
sure.
about them, but
yeah.
there aren't a lot of the core fundamentals that change. It just struck me as how in a relatively short amount of time, a lot has changed in this area. And that's, you know, I think very interesting,
nice
to compare against. But did you want to make one comment or?
Yes, please.
Could you just state your name? Please,
I'm Lawrence Schmidt, and I'm a member of the Alternative Energy Committee. It is probably useful to take a quick excursion and to go and make a reference to the earlier report of an energy committee in 2008, which is 9 years ago. And what I would like to preface that with you is that in that time frame, the laws of thermodynamics stayed the same, but everything else changed. So back then, geothermal was looked at favorably, and it compared economically favorable with solar at the time. Today, that is no longer the case. Further, economically, and that's the most important part, is in order to become economically feasible, you have to go and find financing concepts for these technologies. It's not so much just to have the technology. If you have to pay for it out of pocket, it's one scenario. If you find a financing plan that frees you up from doing so, is another. And we looked at the probability of being able to realize that without incurring a burden on the budget. And so that was one of the drivers. And that led us fairly quickly to a highly scalable solar energy solution rather than other equally valuable renewable energy concepts and technologies, but maybe not for this set of circumstances. And so we can... let me use an analogy when you say we should make a comparison and make reference to that. when you buy a car today and you look at the engine and you look at the same combustion engine, but you look at it 10 years ago, you will find that there's not a lot of things in common other than the principle, right? And going back and making reference, and is that better or was this better, it's just not relevant, right? And a lot of that is true in the solar energy field, but also in renewable energy, that the set of circumstances that existed 9 years ago was a very different one from the one we find today. Given that, it may sometimes not be a productive use of time to focus too much of what has been, right, rather than what is now and what will be in the future. That is our opinion, that it matters most to look forward and to find a technology that has shelf life, if you will, and not so much do a comparison to history, which does not say in any way that the work that was done then was not highly competent and highly relevant for the time it was performed in. So I hope you don't construe my words here as denigrating that earlier work and say it's not really relevant. Things have changed. That is the reason for that. Thank you.
Any other comments or discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of acknowledging receipt of this report and moving on to our workshop on February 28th. Great, thank you very much. Next item up, and thank you again very much for being here and for your presentation. Next item up is number 53-2017, the marijuana moratorium ordinance.
Yes.
Go ahead, Patty.
Okay, back to me.
Yep, busy night for ordinance.
Right, exactly. So as you all know, we are currently under a 90-day emergency ordinance that was approved on December the 12th. And we did this to put a moratorium on retail marijuana businesses that could potentially come and be part of the town. We have before you, we're asking for the council this evening to approve a conventional moratorium this evening, which would be extending the moratorium on retail marijuana businesses for an additional 180 days. And this is extension allows us to further study the issue, and that will go into effect. What we're asking for is for March the 12th. And you might say, why aren't we doing this next month? It's because our next meeting's not until March the 13th. So if we do not approve this evening, we will have a kind of a gap. And so that's why we're bringing this forth now. And the ordinance, based on the law, would remain in effect and will expire in 180 days. And after the effective date, will expire unless earlier extended, repealed, or modified by the town. So with that, I'll make a motion, and certainly we can leave this up for discussion. I move to approve the proposed ordinance pursuant to 30-AMRS, subsection 4356, providing for 180 days effective March 12, 2017. The ordinance shall expire at the end of the 180th day after its effective date, unless earlier extended, repealed, or modified by the town.
Thank you, Patty. Is there a second? Jessica?
Sarah, Jessica. Out a second.
That's okay. Go ahead, Jessica. Second. Discussion. Jessica?
I fully support this. I think it's the wise thing to do. And I know that Matt can share also the comments we heard yesterday at Metro Coalition of Government that most communities are doing exactly the same thing for the same reasons. We just don't know what's going to happen. And we need to see a little more of what the state's doing, and perhaps Matt could speak a little more to that.
Go ahead.
Sure. No, I'd be happy to. Yesterday we did talk about this for quite a period of time as an adjunct to the opioid discussion as well. Many of the communities that are our peers are pursuing similar approaches and doing the moratorium approach because, quite frankly, the state is in the rulemaking process right now. And it's a question of finding out what the landscape is going to look like under what the legislature is going to bring forward for laws.
Yeah.
And so most folks are waiting to that point in time. Coincidentally enough, the legislature also extended their deadline by, I believe it was 60 days beyond where they can make, or what they're using for time period to make changes to the law. So we'll wait and see where that goes. The only community that I know of that is not pursuing the moratorium, at least locally, is South Portland. And I guess the phrase that I would use there is, you can marry in haste and repent at your leisure. Their thought is that they're going to address it immediately because of they have different motivations and they have different pressures, but they feel to make a decision now is good for them. And then if the state comes up with something contrary, they're going to have wording within their own ordinances and laws that state that they can, you know, they don't supersede the state. The state obviously trumps what the local ordinance is if it's in competition with each other. So, but the other communities, and I'm thinking about Scarborough, I know the town that I live in, Gray, is also, we came out of the box with 180 days, but that was back in September. So as a footnote, this would be set to expire on September 8th. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of buys you all that time up to that point, with the approval for the moratorium taking place on March 12th. So that's 180 days from there. So
you saw me looking at my calendar.
Yeah. I did that earlier today. Like, you know, the classic, what's 180 days from such on the internet, and it came forward. So that's what you're looking at, and that's not a hard line. You still do have that ability. If the state doesn't make any decision or any recommendations by that point, you can still extend your moratorium to meet what the needs are for the community. So this just buys you time to see what the landscape's going to shape up as.
Great, thank you. I was going to ask a question specifically to that point, because, and I know that I think Patty, you and some others are going to the event that you mentioned in a week and a half or so. But my question, I mean, I think it's likely we're going to be back here in September without enough action having taken place. So I guess my question is there a reason to not have it be more than 180 days at this point?
I believe 180 days is
your upper limit. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you for clarifying.
The emergency that buys you 90.
Yep.
And then, but you can buy what the statute is. You can basically get your 6 months.
Okay.
So, but you do have the right to extend. You can't keep going on indefinitely unless you have a good reason.
Right, as long as you show progress, right, and that you're doing what you need to be doing, then you have a reason to, it can be extended again. So we should, I would hope that we can make enough progress and maybe extend or maybe not, we'll see.
Jessica?
Would any successive extension be 180 days?
You can set up to 180?
Up to,
but
okay.
Say you needed another 90, like, mm-hmm. Say you had a committee that was working on it, they were making good forward progress, and they said, well, we'd like to do it, but we need another 3 months, you can do that. So if you need a window, but your upper limit is 180 days.
Other comments or questions? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion on the floor right now to approve the proposed ordinance for an 180-day marijuana moratorium, effective March 12, 2017, expiring September 8, 2017. Great, thank you very much. Then the last item on our regular agenda, 54-2017. This is a quit claim deed at 10 Great Pond Drive. Are you going to speak to this, sir?
Sure, I'd be happy to. Wearing my hat as the assessor/collector on this one, when taxes are not paid or a person does not meet their responsibilities to pay their property taxes after a certain period of time, the property gets liened. And then that lien, after a certain period of time, matures, meaning that the town then takes ownership of said property. That is what's taking place in this event. The property owner has come forward and brought in their certified amount that they needed to satisfy the town for their indebtedness or their liability. And so what they need to do is they need to make the town whole to get their property back, which we own. But in the process of getting it back, we do a quick claim deed to release the town's interest and get the property back to them.
Great, thank you. Is there a motion to accept the recommendation and authorize the town manager to sign a municipal quick quit claim deed and real estate transfer tax declaration for 10 Great Pond Drive.
So moved.
Patty, is there a second? Jessica, any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor? Great. At this point, if there are any citizens remaining that wish to speak to anything not on the agenda that pertains to Cape Elizabeth local government, please come on forward. No? Great. As was mentioned earlier, we have a workshop following this regular meeting, so if there's no further business, I'll look for a motion to adjourn. Sarah? Second by Penny. All those in favor? Great. Thank you very much. Good night, everybody. Yep. Thank you.